Shanoz, sir, good evening.
എക്സിക്യൂട്ടീവ് മീറ്റിംഗ് 9 മണിക്കാണോ?
സമയം ഒരുപാട് കളയാൻ പറ്റത്തില്ല എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. തുടങ്ങണം നേരത്തെ.
ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് സാർ. പുരുഷോത്തമൻ സാർ.
ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ് ഷനവാസ്. കേൾക്കണില്ലേ?
കേക്കാം കേക്കാം സാർ. എവിടെ ജോയിൻ ചെയ്തത്?
ഞാൻ MES ല് പെരിന്തൽമണ്ണ. ഓ
എത്ര ദൂരം ഉണ്ട് വീട്ടിൽ നിന്ന്?
ഞാൻ ഇങ്ങോട്ട് താമസം മാറ്റി. അതുകൊണ്ട് കുഴപ്പമൊന്നുമില്ല.
സാറിന്റെ വീഡിയോസ് എല്ലാം കാണാറുണ്ട് കേട്ടോ.
ഞാൻ പ്രസാദിന്റെ വീഡിയോ ഞാനിന്ന് കണ്ടു. ആ ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ട് ഉണ്ടല്ലോ പ്രസാദേ, ആ ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ട് ഒരു പച്ച നിറത്തിലുള്ള ഒരു ബാക്ക്ഗ്രൗണ്ട്, അതെങ്ങനെ, അത് അവിടെ ഉള്ളതാണോ അത് ഉണ്ടാക്കിയത്?
അവിടെ ഉള്ളതാണ് സാറേ, ഉള്ളതാണത്.
അത്തിരി ആ കളറ് ശരിയല്ലാണ്ട് പോയി എനിക്ക്.
അത് കളറ് മാറണം സാറേ, കുറെ കാര്യങ്ങൾ ചെയ്യാനുണ്ട്.
ബ്രൈറ്റ്നെസ്സും കുറച്ച് കൂട്ടായിരുന്നു.
കൂട്ടണം കൂട്ടണം.
പിന്നെ പ്രസാദിന്റെ താടി ഒന്ന് മാറ്റാമെന്ന് എനിക്ക് തോന്നി.
സാറേ കന്നഡ ഇല്ലാതെ കാണാൻ കൂടുതൽ രസമുണ്ട് പുരുഷോത്തം സാറേ?
കന്നഡ കന്നഡ ഇല്ലാണ്ടും കുഴപ്പമില്ല. താടി
കുറച്ച് ഒന്ന് രണ്ട് വീഡിയോസ് കന്നഡ ഇല്ലാതെ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു.
എന്തായിരുന്നല്ലേ, ഞാൻ പ്രസാദിന്റെ കാര്യം.
പ്രസാദ് സാറേ, നമുക്ക് കറക്റ്റ് ആയിട്ട് തുടങ്ങിയേക്കാം. ചില നമുക്ക് ചിലർക്ക് 9 മണി മീറ്റിംഗ് ഉണ്ടല്ലോ. ഹനോ സാറേ, ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ്.
ഗുഡ് ഈവനിങ്.
ശ്രീലത മാഡം ഉണ്ട്, സിറിൽ സാറുണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ എനിക്ക് വിൽ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ദ പ്രോഗ്രാം, ചില അല്ലെങ്കിൽ താമസിച്ചു പോകണ്ട. ഐ തിങ്ക് വിൽ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് ദ പ്രോഗ്രാം. ഐ ഇൻവൈറ്റ് ഡോക്ടർ ശ്രീ പ്രസാദ് ടു ദി വെൽക്കം സ്പീച്ച്.
സോ റെസ്പെക്ടഡ് പുരുഷോത്തമൻ സാർ, ഷാനവാസ് സാർ, മൈ ഡിയർ ടീച്ചേഴ്സ്, my dear friends and APNs, all dear MOs, good evening to all. And today we are planning to conduct third session of our webinar series, which is getting organized jointly by IAP Alappuzha in association with DMOH Alappuzha and Government Medical College Hospital Alappuzha. We are so happy that IAP is always on forefront in dealing activities for the empowerment of general practitioners, practicing pediatricians at the medical officers of peripheral health institutions. I think you may heard that yesterday ICMR came up with a suggestion of reopening the schools for small kids who are studying in first standard to fifth standard. So we are in a dilemma still, will we get a third wave or not. Anyway, during the first and the second wave, we are majority of pediatric patients may have no symptoms or had mild symptoms, and only 5% needed some hospitalization and some mode of treatment, and only less than 1% population of pediatric patients landed up in ICU or presented with the MIC and other complications, which is comparatively rare but still serious. So to enlighten us on all this, we are having a great faculty today, our Palayavan Shanavas sir. And for moderating the sessions, we have Srilatha Madam and Cyril Rosario sir, two well-known pediatricians to all of you. So on the behalf of IAP Alappuzha, I welcome all of you. Shanavas sir, our two moderators today, Jose sir, Balachandran sir, Purushottaman sir, Savitha Madam, all MOs from DHSI, all IAPNs from Alappuzha and from other branches, pediatric PGs, and any house surgeons and general practitioners, if any. So without wasting much time, we are going to our academic session. But before that, Purushottaman sir, may I have a felicitation from your side?
Felicitation, I am very informal. I am going to come here. So here, I am going to come here. കേൾക്കാൻ വന്ന പ്രത്യേകിച്ചും നിങ്ങളുടെ ഓരോരുത്തരും എനിക്ക് ഞാൻ വളരെ ഇഷ്ടപ്പെടുന്ന ആൾക്കാരാണ്. വ്യത്യസ്തമായിട്ടുള്ള ചിന്തയും ആശയങ്ങളുമുള്ള ആളുകളാണ്. അതൊന്ന് കേൾക്കാൻ വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ആണ് വന്നിരിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ വളരെ ബെസ്റ്റ്, കൂടുതൽ പറഞ്ഞിടാക്കല്ല, കേൾക്കാൻ
വേണ്ടി. മോഡറേറ്റേഴ്സ് മാഡം ആൻഡ് സർ,
Thank you, Sriprasad. Good evening, everybody. Happy to see Purushottaman sir this evening. So today is the third day of our web series on pediatric COVID. And this is our part of the preparation to confront this expected third wave of the present pandemic, in which we fear that our clients, that is children, will be more affected. And in the past two sessions, we were discussing about newborn COVID as well as respiratory management with special reference on pediatrics. And now it is time to discuss pediatric COVID proper, and we have none other than our beloved HOD, Dr. Shana sir. He's the most appropriate person to discuss this topic. And every day we are coming across a newer and newer things regarding information regarding various aspects of COVID. And today, sir will discuss on the different aspects of pediatric COVID as well as multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children. So over to sir.
So good evening to all. Respected fellow pediatrician, Dr. Purushottaman sir, and other faculties, and my dear colleagues. So I am very happy to present this topic in this in the expected third wave of COVID. So everybody is anxiously waiting for the third wave, and some of them are still saying it will not come. So we'll also hopeful that it will not come. So my topic for today is pediatric COVID and MISC. I will approach the topic in the following heading. So am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So epidemiology, pathogenesis, pathology, clinical features and management of COVID, and also something regarding MISC. So coming to COVID, SARS-CoV-2 infection, we all know that it is symptomatic or mildly symptomatic. And we were considering this as a benign condition as far as pediatric population is concerned till the emergence of MISC. So now, because of the emergence of MISC, we will we'll be giving more importance, and we are expecting a third wave which will predominantly affect the pediatric population. We are still more worried. So as far as pediatric COVID is concerned, it accounts for about 10-12% of total infection of which when we are considering less than 20 years. And with regards to admission, if there is a need for admission, 1/3 of our population will directly go to ICU. That's the main difference between pediatric and adult COVID. Coming to the numbers, so far I have searched on the 16-7, so 31 million cases occurred in India, and 0.4 million deaths. And in Kerala, it is around 2.9 million cases and 15,000 deaths, also on 16-7. So again, this is the picture of regarding the age incidence. If you consider 0 to 10 years, it is 3.3 and per percentage. And between 11 to 20 years, it is 8.3. So nowadays, we are predominantly concentrating on age less than 2 years, pediatrics in Western girl, and even in private hospitals, it is up to 20 years or 18, at least 18 years. So we were still on catering only a 12 year old. So if it is like that, it will be about 5-7% of the total infection will be in that population. So coming to why we said it is a pediatric infection is rare in children. COVID is rare in children. Why that is like that? Because we all know the innate immunity in children is better, and we are in children there is also trained immunity. So trained immunity means we are pediatric children population is very much susceptible to repeated viral infection, especially at least three to four infections occurs per year, and their immune system is activated. And also we are giving so many vaccine in the pediatric population, so they have got good trained immunity also. These are the two reasons predominantly And also the ACE receptor distribution, we have known that it is less common in pediatric population. Both this will produce a decreased infection. And we know the children are more protected. Whenever in our house also, we will not allow any child to go out of the house. Once infection occurs, that in that case also, the severity is less because the vascular endothelium is very healthy in pediatrics. Your population as compared to older age group. And there is less chance of coagulation abnormality. And there are less comorbidities in the form of obesity, diabetes is less common in pediatrics. And there is a good vitamin D deficiency in population is also less. You know, as we know, the vitamin D has got an anti-inflammatory property and also an anti-oxidative property. So, but nowadays there is a higher incidence in pediatrics also. Why? So it is because of the family clusters. So the latest serotypes that is very rampant in India and India is very much infectious. So one person in the family, if it get infected, it will be spreading to all others. And also, so far we didn't start any vaccine for children. So there is nowadays more chance of COVID to the children. Coming to the agent, we are very much familiar with the agent. We are not going in detail about this. Coronavirus means a crown shape, which is a single stranded RNA virus, which has got a spike protein by which it will be attaching to the ACE receptors. Along with that, there is envelope protein, and also a membrane protein and a single stranded RNA. Coming to the pathogenesis, there are three main phases. One first is attachment. So it is attached with the ACE receptors in the respiratory epithelium. This respiratory epithelium, where it gets multiplied and it will be destroying the type 2 cells. So the surfactant production is decreased or almost nil. So that will lead to microatelectasis. And subsequently, the type 1 cell also gets infected and get destroyed. So gaseous exchange is also being affected. So ultimately, there will be hypoxia. And when it becomes severe, it can lead to ARDS. And subsequently, it may go for an hyperimmune phase where ARDS will get worsened and even death can happen. This is a pathogenesis in simple. As far as the time frame for pathogenesis is considered, there are three main phases which has been described even in one of our health journal. There are first 5 days, 5 days, 5 days, 15 days. First 5 days, it is a viremic phase where it is the virus get very much multiplied. At the end of fifth day, so most of the children, up to 90% of children, their immune system get activated. The virus get cleared. If the virus is not cleared there, the pulmonary phase enters into the pulmonary phase. And subsequently, where this patient can develop pneumonia and also ARDS, hypoxia like that. And if it is again progress, it will lead to severe infection. So the importance of saving this is, in the first 5 days, we can very well observe the children closely. And you can even start antivirals like nowadays, our monoclonal antibody cocktail can be used, or some other antiviral favipiravir like antiviral can be used. And if it is in the pulmonary phase, it will be the antiviral of choice is remdesivir, or you can use corticosteroids, anticoagulants, and anticoagulants. And in severe case, there is no role of antiviral cases. You should go for steroids and anticoagulants. So this is the time frame for the development of COVID. So what are the pathology? So the pathology is in, we can affect in the lungs, gastrointestinal system, brain, heart, liver, kidney, microcirculation of the heart and other end organs, and eyes. So in all these areas, what is specific is there are a lot of ACE receptors. So this any organ in the body can be affected. Coming to the clinical features, as we all know, the most common symptoms are fever, cough, tiredness, a loss of taste or loss of smell. And other symptoms include sore throat, headache, aches and pains. Diarrhea is very common nowadays. Rash on the skin or discoloration of fingers and toes, or a red and irritated eyes. So a typical manifestation, COVID toss is less than 3%. And GI symptoms are more common, 5 to 10%, and even MISC. So when a child should be tested for COVID? So any symptomatic child, we said there is fever, sore throat like that, you should treat. Or a SADI, you know what is SADI? Acute respiratory infection that needs hospitalization is SADI. And high-risk contact or family clusters, you have to test. And ILA in a child with morbidity, comorbidity, you have to test. And ILA in a child in otherwise admitted in a hospital. Now that is all procedures, surgical procedures, or endoscopy or bronchoscopy, you have to do COVID as a routine. So how will you classify the severity? So there are two types of classification based on. One is based on symptomatology. So it is classified into A, B, C. A is mild, presented as mild sore throat, cough, rhinitis, diarrhea or anosmia. And when there is fever is there, it comes in the B category. Along with that, the severity of the sore throat, cough and diarrhea increases. Or any category patient where there is a high risk for other illness like lung disease, heart disease, kidney disease, etc. Or patients on steroids. In adults, it is pregnant lady and age more than 60 years are the category where a symptom become a category B. And coming to category C, the predominant presenting symptoms include breathlessness, chest pain, drowsiness, fall of blood pressure, and children with ILA with red flag signs. So that is the common red flag sign that we discuss in case of ARA in either sense. And worsening of an underlying chronic condition is also, we will consider it as category C. Coming to the clinical severity, is classified into mild, moderate, and severe. Mild means uncomplicated URA without hypoxia. So it manifests as fever, sore throat, rhinorrhea, etc. But when there is, it is usually category A and B together is mild. And category, even moderate, this mainly is category C. There is tachypnea as the cutoff value or SpO2 less than 95%. So hypoxemia with tachypnea is category or moderate category. And severe category means SpO2 less than 90% with danger sign like inability to feel, grunting, lower chest syndrome, altered sensory seizures. So how will you stratify these children and how will you plan management? So asymptomatic children, when they are identified by screening, they should be in the hospital, in the home, and they can be reviewed periodically with a video meeting or a phone call, and subsequent treatment depending on the severity of the patient. And category A symptoms, there is, as we said, URI without symptom, they should be treated again in the home. If there is some problem in the suitable home is not available, they can be treated in the CFLTC. And then mainly the symptomatic treatment with the paracetamol, ORS, like that thing. And there is there is no role of antivirals, antibiotics, vitamin supplements, or investigation. Nothing is known either. So you have to closely monitor them. Every daily monitoring is with a phone call or in a CFLTC, you can daily physically monitor this children. So the red flag signs, you should tell the parents if there is some breathlessness, that is equal about the cutoff value, the respiratory rate is increased, or respiratory monitoring, either it shows hypoxemia, or urine output decreases, whether there is nasal pharynx present, cold extremities, poor feeling, altered sensorium, excessive fatigability, syncope. These are the danger signs that you have to teach the parents to monitor. And if there is anything comes, they should be coming immediately to the treatment facility. Again, category B, there is patient with the fever and more symptoms of category A. There is no role of antiviral, no ICQ, azithromycin, and also ivermectin, all the treatment protocols is against this medication. Only need is when there is paracetamol. If there is fever, paracetamol. No NSAID or ibuprofen, mefta, like the antibiotics should not be given. If there is some cough, you should be treated with the MDA. So in adults, we used to do a single breath walking test. So it can be extrapolated as a single breath test in a pediatrics. Here, what we used to do is take a normal breath and try to hold as long as possible. If you can hold more, if the child can, if this is possible only a child who is older, more than 5 years or eight years. If the child can hold more than 25 seconds, this patient's cardiopulmonary reserve is okay. If it is between 15 to 25 seconds, there is limited cardiovascular, cardiopulmonary reserve. And if it is less than 15 seconds, very poor cardiopulmonary reserve. So less than 50 seconds, you should admit the patient. In 15-20 seconds, you can make the patient to repeat the procedure and closely monitor that. So this is a single breath test that can be it's just similar to that of 6 minutes walking test in an adult. So cough is often a distressing symptom in most of the children, can persist up to 5 to 7 days. And if usually it is without exertional dyspnea. And in adult, we used to use Budicort. That can be extrapolated in pediatric patients also. MDA, using MDA, you can give Budicort. MDA can be given in when there is a distressing cough. So this is the DGHS monitoring chart for category of mild and moderate cases. So mild cases, you should write the comorbidity and condition 1, 2, and what are the drugs patients on. And you have to record at least 4 times, 8 a.m., 12 p.m., 4 p.m., and 8 p.m., whether the patient sends lethargy, myalgia, or there is a shortness of breath present. Record the temperature if possible, BP, respiratory rate, any cyanosis, chest syndrome, SP. This is a very good monitoring chart. You can extrapolate this in all the category B or mild to moderate cases. This can very well use in your hospitals or in the home situation. So coming to the moderate diseases, we said tachypnea with hypoxemia is moderate. Here the child, they can be managed in the home, but in pediatrics they should be admitted in a taluk hospital facility. So they should admit and they can have oxygen administration, monitoring and investigations. And here again, there is no role of routine antiviral or antibiotics. So the clean water are things you should monitor: vitals, heart rate, respiratory rate, BP, and SpO2 should be monitored regularly at least 4 times per day, or work of breathing should be assessed. What are the investigation you should do? CBC, platelet count with absolute lymphocyte count, chest X-ray if it is available, RFT, LFT, and inflammatory markers if no clinical improvement occurs. So there is no routine monitoring of inflammatory markers. CRP, D-dimer, ferritin is not routinely needed, but it can be done if this patient is not improving. So coming to oxygen therapy, the indication for oxygen therapy is less than 94% saturation. Once you start oxygen, the target is not 100%, it is 92 to 96% is your target oxygen saturation. You can use nasal prongs, cannula, face mask, oxygen hood, venturi mask, or even NRM. So this, we had a detailed discussion last week. So if you use nasal prongs, the amount of oxygen should be 2 to 4 liters per minute. It will give an oxygen FiO2 of 30 to 40%. And if it is oxygen hood, both port closed, it will give more than 90% saturation FiO2. And face mask, Hudson mask, usually more than 5 liters is the oxygen that should be put, it will give 0.4% oxygen. And this various type of venturi mask will give the FiO2 between 28 to 60. That is written in the venturi mask. You can use that venturi mask, that which one you want. And non-dream breathing mask is given last week. Dr. Shija has already told. This is it should not be given continuously. Okay, so whatever be the oxygen device you use, the target saturation is between 94 to 96. So coming to the severe COVID. So when you suspect severe COVID, when the saturation is less than 90%, you should suspect. Then when there is severe pneumonia by clinically and radiologically, or features of ARDS by your calculation of the oxidation index, or when there is stroke, multi-organ dysfunction, you can suspect. How will you clinically suspect? Whenever the child is coming with grunting, severe retraction of chest, lethargy, poor feeding, somnolence, or seizure, you should suspect severe COVID. They should be admitted in a high dependency unit or an ICU. So what are the investigations you should do? You should look for organ failure. You should look for evidence of thrombosis. You should look for cytokine storms. You should look for HLS. These are the areas you should concentrate for investigation. At admission, you should do a CBC and the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. In adults, there is a very severe lymphopenia. We know the lymphocyte count is 40 to 50% in normally in children. So the lymphopenia is comparatively rare, but any NLR, neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, more than 3.5 indicate you are dealing with a severe, going to have a severe COVID. You should watch them very closely. The organ functions test you should look for RFT, LFT, and also serum electrolytes like that. And every 48 to 72 hours in an unstable patient, you should repeat these investigations: CRP, D-dimer, LDH, CPK, ferritin, SGOT, SGPT, urea, and creatinine. So imagine for ECG, echo, troped ear, troped eye can be done. And chest imaging should be done. So regarding chest imaging, we know everywhere it is X-ray is easily available. But detection of COVID pneumonia in X-ray is usually late. So if for in children, because of the radiation exposure, there is not routinely recommended. CT scan is not routinely recommended. And it is used when there is a severe respiratory symptom is there. For closely monitoring, you can use CT. And there are so many types of classification, CORADS or CT severity index can be used for diagnosing. So CORADS, we know there are three lobes in the right lung and four, two lobes in the left lung. The total, there are five lobes. Each lobe will give 5 points when it is affected, depending on the severity. And the total score is 25. If the score is between 1 to 7, there is mild COVID pneumonia. And if it is 18 to more than 18, it is severe COVID. You treat accordingly based on the CT scan. So the CT scan is not routinely indicated. Only when there is you are suspecting a severe disease, you have to do a CT scan. So this is one of the CT findings. Shows perihilar ground glassing and homogeneous ground glass opacity. And ground glass opacity, the smooth interlobular septal thickening suggests viral pneumonia. It could be COVID or any other viral pneumonia. So severe disease, the management include supportive management. You should give respiratory support. We said what are the respiratory support initially and how will you augment the respiratory support. Hemodynamic support, that will be our next class is on respiratory support on next Thursday in a COVID patient. And steroids, you have to do steroids. You can use steroids or after 5 days of disease. The steroids used commonly are methylprednisolone or dexamethasone. And remdesivir is an indicated patient. There is no added advantage of the studies have shown that he has got no survival mortality, survival benefit, but it will reduce the hospital duration of hospitalization. So you can use after 5 days, within the first 5 days, within the next 5 days, that is within 10 days, you can use remdesivir. If the child has passed 10 days, there is no need for using remdesivir. And you should not worry if the remdesivir is not available. You can give it in the dose of 5 mg per kg IV, maximum 200 mg loading dose, followed by 2.5 mg IV OD for next 4 days. That is total 5 days treatment. You can use lomalgrab heparin, 1 mg per kg subcutaneous OD, if no contraindication for using this one. Coming to the oxygen support, we said till the NRM. So if it is not improving with these things, we can go for HHFNC. The indication, everything has mentioned last week, CPAP, NIV, and other invasive ventilation is the other techniques. So role of steroids. Steroids has got not indicated in asymptomatic or mild cases. Nowadays, our routine practice for general practitioners is you should use steroids whenever there is a COVID. So it will, in fact, steroids prolongs the viral shedding, and hence it should be used at least in the first five days, and also when there is mild or moderate cases. So in hospitalized, moderately severe or critically ill patients, you should use steroids. It should be used after 5 days only, and right dose at right duration. The right dose for dexamethasone is 0.15 mg per kg. Maximum dose is 6 mg. And for methylprednisolone, we said equivalent dose of methylprednisolone also can be used instead of dexona. So coming to antivirus, I have already said remdesivir has got no added advantage in case of only it reduces the duration of hospitalization. And contraindicated when there is RFT abnormalities. Estimated GFR, if it is less than 30 ml, it should not be used. And also STPT abnormality, more than 5 times the normal value STPT, if it is there, it should not be used. So the recent antiviral is, everybody is very much interested about the antibody cocktails, casirivimab, indivimab, This has been the it has become popularized when it was given to Brett. It was given to the our UK US president. The doses for in children, we can use more than 12 is 600 milligram of as a single dose. There are two drugs are there in a single vial, as Remdesivir and Indomie. You should give it together as a single IV infusion. If the IV infusion is not available, we can use a subcutaneous also. It will prevent progression of COVID patient and even prevent hospitalization. There is no need for hospitalization if there is in those patients who are having a high risk in the form of those getting steroids, those getting COPD, severe COPD, renal disease patient. When the in the first 48 hours is 72 hours is very good, and you can give up to first 7 days. Alternatively, you can give bamlanivimab, etesevimab. These are the recent antiviral agents that is that can be used to prevent hospitalization of a in pediatric child. It's it can be used more than 12 years. So what is the role of prophylactic anticoagulants? When it is a pre-existing disease in the form of obesity, in case of nephrotic syndrome with COVID, severe COVID, exacerbation of diseases, sickle cell disease, and autoimmune disease, heart disease, you can use prophylactic anticoagulant. So you can use in high-risk current disease, you can use mechanical ventilation, patients in mechanical ventilation, patients in inotropic infusion, central line, rhythm abnormalities, you can use anticoagulants. So what is the management? You know, the management of ARDS yesterday, last class, it was discussed in some extent. Mild ARDS, there is high flow nasal, we can use high flow nasal oxygen followed by non-invasive ventilation. And severe ARDS, mechanical ventilation can be used with low tidal volume and high PEEP. If child does not improve, in certain situation, you can use high frequency HMO, HFOB or ECMO. In older hypoxemic children, away prone nursing can be done. He can prone up to prone nursing for about 2 to 4 hours, subsequently to right lateral, then to sitting to left lateral. So this is the routine for prone ventilation and prone nursing. It will improve the outcome in a case of severe ARDS patient. It is routinely used in older children. We can routinely use in adult. We can do it in all the children also. So coming to the next part of the talk, that is our multi-inflammatory syndrome. It was first reported in the UK in April 2021. This is the increase of missed cases followed 1 month after COVID surge. So here in Kerala also, in Trivandrum and Alappuzha, we have got a missed surge following the epidemic or pandemic, following the peak pandemic in our district also. They constitute about less than 10% of hospitalized COVID-related illness in pediatrics. Less than 10% of COVID-related admissions due to MISC. So incidence, total incidence is 1 to 2 per lakh COVID infection. It is more common in older children. When there is a comorbidity like obesity or asthma, there is a high chance. We have seen at least out of our 21 patients, 3 to 4 patients was obese in our series also. It is a 3 to 4 weeks interval between COVID and MISC. So it has got close similarity to Kawasaki disease, HLHS, or cytokine storm of COVID pneumonia. So the mean age is between 5 to 9 years, and we had one newborn on second week of one mother who had COVID came in on the second week around second week with severe shock. We thought of a ductipinal lesion, but we refer this patient to a higher center where they have investigated and found that it has newborn COVID. Okay, and also it is more common in all age groups. So if it is 1 to 4 years, it is around 28%, more than up to 60% or 70%, it is more than 5 year old children are affected. So the exact pathophysiology is not known. The possible mechanisms put forward are immune dysregulation, antibody enhancement technique and enhancement, and T cell mediated damage or enhancement of inflammation. So when there is a In children, certain children, there is a rapid interferon response occurs. If there is a rapid interferon response, the viral load decreases very rapidly, and disease will be the viral clearance occurs very early. So there won't be much problem. So when there is a delayed in IL-6 peaking, the viral multiplication continues, and other interferons also produce can have severe COVID and also severe MIS. There is a relation between severity, but even mild or asymptomatic children are coming with MIS. They are once we tested, we found that they have got COVID infection previously. That also can occur. So what is the diagnostic criteria? There are so many. First, it was in the diagnosed in the UK. They have got their own diagnostic criteria. It is very cumbersome, and WHO diagnostic criteria is very easy to recollect. So the first criteria is age between 0 to 19 years with fever more than 3 days. You should suspect any child who is coming with fever without any other thing for more than 3 days. You have to suspect MISC. And the clinical criteria, there are 5 clinical criteria they are sent of which if there are 2, again you should suspect. The skin manifestations are bilateral, non-purulent conjunctivitis, mucocutaneous inflammation in the oral cavity, hands or feet, just like that of our Kawasaki disease. Any child coming with fever, with hypotension and shock, you should suspect a MISC. And features of myocardial dysfunction or pericarditis or valvulitis or coronary abnormalities, including echo finding or elevated property, that is investigation or by investigation there is a myocardial dysfunction, again you should suspect. Then evidence of coagulopathy in the form of PTA, PTT or elevated D-dimer, again you should suspect. And GIT symptoms, diarrhea, vomiting, abdomen. So if from the 5 clinical features, if you 2, again it suggests COVID. And elevated markers of inflammation, CRP, ESR, procalcitonin, and these things should not be explained by some other condition in the form of bacterial sepsis, staphylococcal, scarlet, staphylococcal shock syndrome, or staphylococcal shock syndrome should not be explained from these symptoms. And there should be an evidence of previous COVID infection. It could be an RT-PCR positivity, antigen test positivity, or antibody positivity. Recent antibody positivity should be there. So if these are there, you should suspect COVID. The usual skin manifestations are maculopapular rash, blotchy, erythemas, and even rashes like this can be presented. So the investigations are you will classify the tier 1 investigation and tier 2 investigation for ease of administration. So all patients you should suspect, patient you should do hemoglobin, there may be anemia, there will be polymorphonuclear leukocytosis, and ALC is usually 1000 per cubic millimeter, platelet count less than 1.5 liters per microliter, ESR more than 40, CRP. So all these investigations you can do in all taluk hospitals. You should suspect a suspected COVID. If it is abnormal, you should either go for the second app where echo is available, you can do it, or and these are available, you can do, or you can send to a higher center. So all taluk hospital, you should do the tier 1 investigations and go to or refer to tier 2. So ECG, echo, proBNP, proTORI, ferritin, procalcitonin, D-dimer, PTA, PTT, fibrinogen, LDS, triglycerin, etc. You need not do all the investigation. So there are, for ease of administration, you can divide into each one. So one in the cardiac panel. Cardiac panel could be proBNP, proPI with echo. Then you can do a vascular panel in the form of D-dimer, PTA, PTT, fibrinogen. Or you can do, you can do ESR-CRP. So ESR-CRP with 1 or 2 tests from each panel, you can do. Then, so coming to the treatment. So IV immunoglobulin is, immunomodulation is the treatment of COVID. So the main drugs used are IV immunoglobulin or methylprednisolone or steroid. So IV immunoglobulin is preferred in children less than 5 years, where there is a predominant Kawasaki-like illness, or where there is a coronary artery involvement. If there is not like that, you can go a much cheaper drug, So I will be coming to that one. So the dose of IV immunoglobulin is 2 gram per kg over 8 to 12 hours, or in a longer period if there is cardiac function, a cardiac dysfunction. You should include oral prednisone or methyl prednisone along with immunoglobulin. So you should give these two together in a case of severe MISC less than 5 years. So if it is more than 5 years is there, and severe COVID is there, if severe MISC is there, you can start 30 milligram per kg for 3 days of methyl prednisone, followed by 2 milligram per kg per day of oral prednisone for 1 week. Till CRP is normal, then taper over 2 to 3 weeks. Total steroid should be only up to 2 to 3 weeks. You are not supposed to give more steroid because of the, we know so many fungal infections are very common nowadays because of the rampant use of, irrational use of steroids. So steroids should be used in right time. These two are in severe MISC, not in a mild MISC. Mild MISC will be you should more closely monitor the CRP and other inflammatory markers. So if there is cardiac involvement is there, repeat echo and ECG should be done after 1 week and after 4 to 6 weeks, when the child become 4 to 6 weeks after the treatment. So if the initial echo is abnormal, you should repeat again at the end of 1 year. So coming to the refractory MISC, if the patient is not responding, the fever is not subsiding, or the worsening of shock, or rising of inflammatory markers, you can do alternative drugs. If the patient was on IVIG, you should go to methyl prednisone pulse dose, that is 30 milligram. If the patient was on methyl prednisone, you can give IVIG. Unlike the Kawasaki, in a case of Kawasaki disease, if there is recurrence is there, you should not responding, you will use repeated with a dose of IVIG, but in MISC routinely we are not repeating IVIG. So coming to the anticoagulation, the indications for anticoagulation include clinical thrombosis, ejection fraction less than 35 in when you do echo, and in the coronary artery aneurysm with more than 10 Z score of coronary artery size. So you can use a low molecular weight heparin in case of MISC with cardiac dysfunction. When the ejection fraction is less than 35, directly use MISC, low molecular weight heparin. Or MISC with hepatic derangement, you start with, you can use aspirin. So in that case, you start with low molecular weight heparin, and once the LFT become normal, you can start aspirin. When there is documented thrombosis is there, thrombosis is documented, start both low molecular heparin and aspirin together. And large coronary artery with Z score more than 10, again you should use low molecular weight heparin and aspirin together. Coming to the role of aspirin, it's used in antiplatelet dose of 3 milligram per kg, and the maximum dose is 75 milligram daily. And if the platelet is, the platelet should be more than 80,000 per cubic millimeter, and SGPD should be normal in before using aspirin. And it should be given for 4 to 6 weeks. And if the echo is normal, you can stop aspirin. Long-term aspirin is given in case of coronary artery aneurysm. So the anticoagulant of choice is enoxaparin 1 milligram per kg BD, and with a target factor 10 of 0.5 to 1. This is a flowchart of MISC. It is a DGHS slide. So if there is an unremitting fever of more than 38 degree, or epidemiological link of SARS-CoV-2, or clinical features of suggestive of MISC, if it is there and the patient is in shock or life-threatening manifestations are present, go for simultaneously tier 1 and tier 2 together. And if the initial this is not typically there, you can evaluate for alternate diagnosis. Fever or alternate diagnosis can be there. And if these symptoms are there and there is no shock, tier 1 evaluation we already said. And if the tier 1 evaluation is positive, you can go for tier 2 evaluation. And if this patient is by investigation, patient is fulfilling the criteria for MISC, and if there is any cardiac dysfunction, shock or coronary artery involvement or multi-organ dysfunction or life-threatening condition, go to the management, that is steroid. In case of mild, you can use the steroids 1 to 2 milligram per kg or plus IVIG, or antibiotics, if you can't exclude a bacterial infection, especially when you suspect a toxic shock syndrome, you can start ceftriaxone with clindamycin. Otherwise, there is no need for antibiotics. If you can't rule out sepsis, you should start antibiotics, IV immunoglobulin, and also steroids. So, if there is nothing is there, you can rule out tropical infections like leptospirosis or weevils or dengue. All this can be considered. And if there is no improvement or worsening is there, we can use high dose of methylprednisolone. So, you can initially low dose methylprednisolone in mild cases or in severe cases with the shock and other complications, you can go directly to methylprednisolone high dose. Okay, so aspirin and enoxaparin, we already mentioned. So, coming to the risk data in TDMCs, we had in the as on June 21, we had 21 total cases, which there was a male predominance of 71% and female of around 76-78%. And the serious involvement was the main one with 33%, that is 7 out of 21, 7 had cardiac serious by echo and clinically also. And skin and mucosal involvement, that is 100% patient had this one. RT-PCR positive in 3 patients, COVID antibody in 7, remaining 17. And both RT-PCR and antibody positive in 3 patients. And previous history of COVID was present only in 2 patients. This was our statistics where, in the till last month. And we treated the patient, 7 patients we gave IVIG, and we gave the remaining 12 we gave either prednisolone and IVIG either prednisolone together for 1 patient. There was no death event, all the patients survived, and there was no permanent coronary artery aneurysm also. So coming to the last part of my talk, that is prevention. We know we can prevent by vaccine. The vaccine trials are in the stage 2 and stage 3. Regarding the most important vaccine, that is, we are the vaccine that is will give more hope is Covaxin. So it has got phase 2 trial almost over. They are starting this from 2 years on. There are so many different age group they are doing trial. So from 2 years also onwards also they are using 2-dose regimen. And Pfizer and Moderna vaccine, it is nowadays itself it is being used more than 12 years in Israel. And even in US, they are advising all children more than 12 years, they are using Pfizer. There is a Pfizer vaccine, there is a higher incidence of myocarditis when they use Pfizer. Coming to the latest vaccine that is in the pipeline, they are in the last week, health secretary has told that this vaccine is the one that is going to be used in pediatrics. This is Cyrus Cadila vaccine, that is CIFCOVID. It is a DNA plasmid technology. You know, as you know, the DNA containing gene for COVID antigen is incorporated into plasmid and is injected using a needleless technology. That is, they are using what is called farmjet technology, where rapidly it is with a spring action, it is going into the body without a needle. So there are 3 doses. There are trials with the 3 doses and 2 doses, and they are doing a very high seroconversion, even up to more than 95% they are seeing. So I think this will be the first vaccine in pediatrics that can be used. So coming to the prevention, you know, the prevention other than vaccine, the SMS, the old SMS, we have already practicing, that is hand hygiene, sanitization, and usual spacing and safe distance, SMS. And also the 3 C's should be avoided. You should avoid crowded place, you should avoid close space, and also you should use close contacts. So by observing these, we can prevent infection in spite of vaccination. We know we are all vaccinated, but we are still continuing these techniques, and we should continue that also. Then, okay, so that comes to the end of my talk. So thank you for the patient listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Shana, sir, for your informative talk regarding this COVID-19 and also the MISC, which is increasing in number in the ICU admission. I think those who are having any queries can unmute and ask directly to sir.
Sir, there is a chat box. There is questions. Yeah, then I'll ask from the chat box. First question, one incidence
of MISC is very low, and can the correlation with COVID-19 a myth? Like Kawasaki disease, it's only an abnormal immune response to any infection by a genetically susceptible host. Any gene studies done in MISC? Also, any MISC reported in the recent predominant Delta lineage infection?
So we don't know the exact cause, but there is only after coming the epidemic. So there is a direct relation between epidemic and 3 to 4 weeks later, there is MISC is coming. So we are strongly epidemiological link is there, and there is a serological link. The COVID antibody is positive in majority of cases. As a diagnostic criteria, we are considering antibody positivity as well. So we don't know but some other etiology. So Kawasaki disease also, we are thinking viral infection because it is occurring multiple. They are coming as skin rash, fever, oral mucocutaneous lesion like that. Okay, so Purushottam sir, sir's opinion regarding this one. Purushottam sir.
Muted. About the previous question, it's only worldwide it is proved. It's not Kawasaki. Something which looked like Kawasaki, there are differences in the clinical picture itself. Many of the cases are not coronary vessels are not involved. Typically in Kawasaki, what is happening is the coronary vessels are the predominant ones involved, and there can be a myocardial involvement. All the cases of the cardiac problems, we are getting a big number of myocardial dysfunction, ejection fraction involvement, shock-like situation. Kawasaki with the shock is less than 10% cases, even less in a typical Kawasaki shock. Here, the shock is the predominant presentation, and the myocardial dysfunction is the predominant. The coronary vessels are less involved. Many other ways, it's not the same as Kawasaki. It looks like Kawasaki, that's all. The incidence in India, the first number of series they presented was from the Kanji Kamakodi. They reported almost 23 cases, and out of which one death. Then Bombay series, again, I think it's 19 cases. The mortality was less. That was in early 2020. The reported cases, they started first in, I think, UK, then in Italy and Europe, where the case series was almost 78 cases or so. That was the first case internationally. The Indian series, Kanji Kamakodi, then Bombay, and I don't know the total number nation-wise. The first, in Chanavas, the statistics in India, actually Maharashtra had the maximum number of cases. The percentage of affection in kids is 6% only. Throughout the state, if you take, the ranges is from 4 to 12%. So the other states, it's not Maharashtra, but the other states are having more number. And as you said, in Kerala, MISC, I think it's more than 500 cases must be there. I have just what we follow. We are not routinely giving aspirin in all the cases. The aspirin is being given in coronary vessel involvement. What we are having as an echo evidence is most of the cases are having myocardial involvement, the ejection fraction low. In that situation, usually we give the anticoagulant only. Aspirin is not routinely given unless there is a coronary involvement. The pathology cannot be equated to the Kawasaki and give all the cases of aspirin. Actually, it's not needed. Anticoagulant indicated case only is needed. And about the treatment part, whether there is a role for the mental fitness around 10 mg per kg. The less than 6 years you are giving the IVIG always, definitely that's indicated, and not responding to the middle prednisolone high dose again. Above 6 years, we are going for the middle prednisolone 30 milligram per kg 3 days and non responding only IVIG. There, should we give all cases 30 milligram per kg, or some cases where we are not presenting with shock and all, 10 milligram per kg isn't enough, is one question. About the remdesivir, I have got a totally different view about the remdesivir. It's not a time-tested drug in children. That's the most important thing. It may prove to have some problems in later situation. We have a tendency to jump to something which comes, and there are people recommending this thing even in the newborn. How you can give such a drug which doesn't have any experience to give to a newborn? It just got a no value, in fact. Just the discharge of shortening for 4 days. But else, no morbidity, mortality, morbidity reduction, and too costly. And such a drug, if at all you ask me my personal opinion, I'll reserve remdesivir for the kids who are susceptible, high-risk people, kids, if we will be giving as a prophylactic, so that it will be acting. If at all there is an action, it should be reserved less than 5 days we can give. You cannot decide about the antiviral drug to give later. There is no use beyond even the 5 to 10 days I want. Because by the time symptoms come, not due to MISC, but the other situation also, all are immune mediated. There are two types of immune mediated injury in pediatric age group. In adult, beyond 7 days, every system problems are due to the immune mediated injury, not due to virus. In the pediatric age group, again, there is a first situation of immune mediated injury which is happening after the 5 days to the part where you are getting all sort of actual COVID scenario, 1% the cases of ICU admission during the initial part. The COVID, the MISC scenario is again an immune mediate, that is a late onset situation. Late onset situation, there is no question of using remdesivir, even in the percentage of 15% RT-PCR positive. There is no absolute no for remdesivir. In an other situation also, by the time symptoms comes on the 7th day, even though some people are recommending remdesivir in Cat C, severe, well, it's a waste, because if at all there are viral particles at that stage, the pathology is entirely due to immune-mediated. Viral particle viable will not count, will not be responsible at all. So absolutely there is no need for antivirals in the pediatric age group as such, except in a situation where high-risk people we can start, if possible, within the 5 days. Newborn, never. It is because it won't do good, and you don't know the without experience, you should not be using it. So I'll stop my comment.
Thank you, sir, for your comments. So regarding the dose of median prednisone, so when in the first wave, we are using very high dose, that is 30 milligram per kg. For 3 days forward. Nowadays, we are using only 1 to 2 milligram per kg. And it's equally effective, it's not much difference. And almost all the protocols are seeing aspirin. So we are routinely giving aspirin. We don't know whether it is essential or not. But I discussed with Dr. Shija. She is also saying she used to give aspirin, that is 75 milligram, till five weeks, that is still the first follow-up scan is normal. In the first follow, because she is saying that there can be even though there is no aneurysm, there can be endothelial damage. So that itself can produce later problem. So better to give aspirin also. So these are the two things. Regarding remdesivir, I am also against. We haven't given any patient remdesivir. We had also one patient moderate to severe pneumonia. We didn't give anything. We give only antibiotics, even though it is not very much indicated. Because of the fear, we give antibiotics, they recover. But so far, in my experience, we didn't use in an anterior phase, there is not a single pediatric patient receive remdesivir. But others are saying that if they are using sufficiently early, it is better. They are seeing better prognosis, even though the recommendation is only in severe cases. Even moderate cases, if they use, they are saying that we can prevent going to severe cases.
Okay. So another question is there any state-wise and national data and the stats, I think the statistics on MISC in first wave and in second wave?
So I got only the Trivandrum data. There are around 70 cases. I think 73 cases from Trivandrum in the first wave. We have got only 10 cases in TDMCs. I think all medical colleges, they know the
first wave we had 19 cases and now it's almost 40 cases and we had one death in the first wave and here in this wave also we had one death, but most of the cases are having good response during this apart from the one case which died due to shock, intractable shock, which couldn't be revived. And one important message is the peripheral pediatricians should not be delaying too much of during the suspicion transfer and the delaying of the steroid, because even this 1 to 2 milligram per kg of the methylprednisolone, if you are suspecting, they should get early. One case which we missed in the first phase was a case of a complete heart block. We are getting many ECG changes, many type of arrhythmias, lethal arrhythmia on the first time. And that patient we lost, that was referred for pacing. And even in spite of all these things, the patient didn't survive. And that situation, a little late was the starting of the steroid. And the other case, there are selected cases which is not responding to, in spite of all the management, where ECMO is the only answer. So there's Amrita, they did an ECMO. And KIMS also, I think, they are doing ECMO. ECMO may be useful, but it should not be jumping for it early. There should be clear-cut guidelines to go for it. But there are situations where you may need ECMO.
So another question is regarding hepatic involvement, up to how much severity have you come across?
So we used to see transaminitis, elevated transaminitis, around, I think, thousands, less than thousands only. More than thousands, we haven't any case so far. I think the last patient we had, one patient we had, that is, I think it's around 1,200. That patient, we didn't give any aspirin.
Another question, role of ECG after 1 year, I think it must be in missing 1 year, I think one.
Okay, 1 year, if there is a coronary artery involvement, there can be ECG and ECG abnormality can be there. So, and echo, ECG and echo can be done. So usually nowadays cardiologists only see patients after taking an ECG. So you should go for an ECG and X-ray. If there is a coronary artery involvement, there can be abnormality.
Can steroids be started from day one in CAT-C?
So depending on the the time of onset, the time frame you should decide. So it is not the time of doing test. It is the time of onset of symptom. So when was the start of the upper respiratory tract infection, running nose, sore throat, everything. So in that case, usually it will be only after 5 days. Our time calendar is almost similar. So it will be only after 5 days. So once there is a severe COVID or severe risk, you can start steroid. There is no problem.
Any correlation noted by D-dimer values and severity?
So the D-dimers, it is said that D-dimer is used for exclusion of other conditions. So if there is D-dimer is negative, you can tell it is not due to somewhat selective mammals. The positive D-dimer doesn't indicate it is a COVID. So that is usually used to tell.
So I think the last question is, any role for high dose methylprednisolone in severe COVID as given in MISC?
So the dose of steroid, that is usually methylprednisolone or dexamethasone, The maximum dose is 6 milligram in case of COVID, and an equivalent dose of metoprolol. That is, we can pulse is, I think, on indicator. Prashant sir, what is your opinion?
Which one?
COVID.
There are it should be right timing, as Chandra was said. Early before 5 days should be avoided. After that, depending upon the category. Questions are kind of sir. About the last part of the vaccination. But what about should be our stand on the vaccination, and what should be IAP stand on the school opening? These are the 2 points. I think I may differ from most of you. Oru different aayidlare oru stand aayidondum vivadathinulla saadhyathe ulladondum njan idu parnju vekka. I am against starting giving vaccine to less than 20 years. Endu kondana ennu njan parneram. Not for the time being. Ippam Bharat Biotech in the study will come. Shanavas Varna Sitkov Varuno should be hurry for a vaccine. That is the most important thing. All the vaccine we used over time are time tested. Post-marketing surveillance phase 4 on the table. Safety established beyond doubt. I know. Namudu idu vare use cheyirunna pediatric age group use cheyirunna ella vaccines. None of them we jumped and grabbed it. If pharmaceuticals um bakkala aalkarinte appo oru 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 the fear for the marketing undava. We should always think twice before going for a drug or vaccine, just like remdesivir. ഒന്ന് പറയുമ്പോഴത്തേക്ക് നമ്മൾ ചാടിപ്പോയി ന്യൂ ബോൺ വാക്സിൻ കൊടുത്തു. ഈസ് ആർ എ നീഡ് ഫോർ എ വാക്സിൻ ഫോർ എ പീഡിയാട്രിക് ഏജ് ഗ്രൂപ്പ്? രണ്ട് മൂന്ന് കാര്യങ്ങളാണ്. ഒന്ന്, നൺ ഓഫ് ദീസ് വാക്സിൻ ഹാവ് പ്രൂവ്ഡ് സേഫ്റ്റി. സീ ദ mRNA വാക്സിൻ യു എസ് ഉള്ളതും ഭാരത് മറ്റേ ഫൈസർ ബയോൺടെക് വന്നു, mRNA വന്നു, ആൻഡ് ഇസ്രായേൽ യൂസ് ചെയ്തു. ദർ വെർ അഡോളസെൻസിലെ വെർ റിയാക്ടിങ് ഡിഫറെന്റ്ലി. There were big number of myocarditis, but many of them were transient, no death in the adult population. But adults are behaving a bit differently. There were death in the adolescents in Israel. And how can we boldly say that there won't be problems? Because the nucleic acid content in the Bharat, these both Moderna and Pfizer is much higher than what is needed. In the vector adenovirus is much higher than what is needed. So is we need to know more about the actual dose. Is there a need for this much of the mRNA or a little lower dose? Will it be effective? So korchudi study vannote safety establish cheyidite a little lower dose aanu verndathu anganeulla establish cheyyunnathu vare. Is there a need for a hurry? അതാണ് ചോദിക്കുന്നത്. ദ നമ്പർ ഓഫ് കേസസ് ഹാവിംഗ് കോംപ്ലിക്കേഷൻസ് വി നോ ഇത്രയാണ് പെർസെൻറ്റേജ് എന്നുള്ള കാര്യം. ദ മോർട്ടാലിറ്റി ഈസ് മേ ബി 1 in 10,000, ആൻഡ് ഈവൻ ദറ്റ് ക്യാൻ ബി പ്രിവെൻറ്റഡ് ഇൻ ദ ടൈംലി. വട്ട് ഇസ് നീഡഡ് ഈസ് ആൾ പീഡിയാട്രീഷ്യൻസ് ഓൾ ദ ജനറൽ പ്രാക്ടീഷണേഴ്സ് ഷുഡ് ബി അവെയർ ഓഫ് ദിസ് തിങ് ഏർലി ഡിറ്റക്ഷൻ റൈറ്റ് ട്രീറ്റ്മെന്റ് മോർട്ടാലിറ്റി ക്യാൻ സ്റ്റിൽ ബി റെഡ്യൂസ്ഡ് ഇഫ് യു ആർ ഗോയിങ് ഫോർ എ വാക്സിൻ വട്ട് ഇസ് എ നമ്പർ ടു ബി വാക്സിനേറ്റഡ് less than 20 years in the number in Kerala is 90 lakhs every year. 5 lakhs kids are born. 20 years in the mele vaccination kodukkiyanagale we need 1 lakh to 1 crore of kids less than 20 years. You need to give 2 doses of this mRNA vaccine, whichever vaccine. എത്ര ഡോസ് കൊടുക്കണം? നമ്പർ ടു ട്രീറ്റ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ അത്രയും ആൾക്കാർക്ക് കവർ ചെയ്തിട്ട് നമുക്ക് സേവ് ചെയ്യാൻ പോകുന്നത് എന്തിനാണ്? ദ മോർട്ടാലിറ്റി ഓഫ് എത്രയോ 1 in 10,000. സോ ഈസ് ഇറ്റ് വേർത്ത്? ഈസ് ഇറ്റ് നീഡഡ്? നമ്മളിപ്പം ജമ്പ് ചെയ്തിട്ട് ചാടിപ്പോകേണ്ട കാര്യമുണ്ടോ? ലെറ്റ് ഇറ്റ് എസ്റ്റാബ്ലിഷ് സേഫ്റ്റി. വിൽ വെയിറ്റ് ഫോർ ഇറ്റ്. വട്ട് എവർ സ്ട്രാറ്റജി വി ആർ ഡൂയിങ്, ഐ എം നോട്ട് അറ്റ് ഓൾ അഗൈൻസ്റ്റ് എനി ഓഫ് ദി അതർ തിങ്സ്. എല്ലാ പോളിസിയും പോകണം. പക്ഷേ വാക്സിന്റെ കാര്യത്തിൻ്റെ ഭാരത് ബയോടെക് വിൽ കം ഔട്ട് ഓഫ് ദിസ് വാക്സിൻ മേ ബി ഇൻ ഓഗസ്റ്റ്. they will complete the study. Appadhekku adinte melekku povu. In which country, a European country, are giving COVID vaccine, Covishield, less than 40? Very few. Many European countries cut off the age for the Covishield is above 65. Few of them above 60. UK, they are giving above 40. For less than 40, Covishield in the government, they are viewing with some anyway. We don't have any other alternative. We have only two vaccines. Definitely, we need to give the vaccine. Covishield in the very at least for when you choosing a vaccine less than 20, why not wait for establishing safety? Or should it samya kainitte no cheyidoda? It's not for never disagreeing. Vaccine A vandanalla. We should be waiting rather than jumping for it in the coming months when the vaccine comes for the pediatric age group. Adana oru kaaryam. Randamatha kaaryam, the school entry. School entry definitely nammal IAPM standard at the earliest school entry vandadona. Avade the Bhargava ICMR chairman has come out with an argument that less than 5 years should be started. I have a different opinion. It should not be the same. Anginella, mele kuttalukku thottu thalavottaanu saattendathaanu enna thonnu. Why? Because the school in the povaadirikkunnathinte problem evidiyaanu? Psychosocial, psychological problems of the kids and their vyaktitva vikasathinte prashnangalum aanu. Who are affected maximally because of the no school? Anju vayasinu thaazhe kuttikku ellam parents undu veettilundu veettil sugamaanu. Appo avarude psychosocial milieu onnum disturbed aayittilla. So who are the maximum affected is the adolescent and the older. So it should be the in the reverse order. The school should be started without delay, taking all the precautions. There should be a redesign of the school considering the most importance of the masking and the distancing, and every change in the school should be happening, but it is in the reverse order. Ee rendu point aanu enikku parayanathu. Agree, Josephine mogam kanda ariya. ഒരു ഡിഫറൻസ് ഒപ്പീനിയനും അങ്ങനെ ഒരുപാട് ആൾക്കാർക്ക് ഡിഫറൻസ് ഒപ്പീനിയൻ ഉണ്ടാവും. ഐ ഹാവ് ബട്ട് ഡിഫറൻസ് സ്റ്റാൻഡ്. അത് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞു മാത്രം.
Thank you, sir. You have brought about certain points we have to ponder on. We have to think a lot before introducing all these things. Thank you, sir. Over to Sri Prasad.
Joe, sir.
I think the important point raised by Purushottam sir regarding the school opening, I think that is a one debatable issue. We had to discuss a lot and then decide, give a comment, because there is a lot of issues regarding the opening and all. I think it was an excellent talk by our HOD Dr. Shanawas sir. So with congratulations to Shanawas sir for excellent presentation of COVID and miskin influence, and the comment by Purushottam sir and the chair by Dr. Srilada, Dr. Cyril. And now I invite Dr. Reshma, our secretary AAP Alappuzha, to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. First of all, I would like to thank Shanawas sir for that very simple and basic presentation. It was very informative. Thank you, Cyril sir and Srilata madam, for chairing the session. And special thanks to Purushottaman sir for attending our meeting and adding on so many points and so many things which we have to think about. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you all the seniors and all the pediatricians for joining the session. Thank you so much.
So our next session will be on next Thursday.
Wednesday. SOC management of related problems in COVID. SOC and cardiovascular problems.
Okay. So now we can wind up the session.
Thank you. Good night, sir. Good night. Good night, sir. Cyril, sir. Good. Good night. See you later, good night.
Thank you, sir.